So I'm going to tell you a little bit about non-coding RNA, but since you mentioned Notch, and then I have a few slides in the beginning about Notch for the old time's sake, I guess. This is just as an introduction, our interest, that summarizes our interest, like many other people, obviously. We're interested in how the heart adapts to stress, myocardial infarction, for instance. And there's different mechanisms, obviously, that contribute to the formation of the scar. Hypertrophy, fibrosis, all this is known. But I mentioned here maybe the major player for which we have an interest, and the cardiomyocyte, obviously, the fibroblast, and also the cardiac precursor cells. I think there's still room for involving these cells in the response of the heart to stress. And the whole idea is obviously to find a way to reverse this process and produce more cardiomyocyte and try to restore the function of the heart. Now, if you want to produce more cardiomyocyte, one of the different ways of to hypothesize how it could happen, simple hyperplasia of immature cardiomyocyte, the differentiation, and then the reintroduction of the cell cycle in the mature cells that you might produce, but also relying on resident cardiac precursor. So I mentioned here cardiac stem cells. I mean, this is used in the literature. I immediately say that I don't believe that this cell exists in the heart. I do believe that we have precursor cells, but true cardiac stem cells, in the sense that stem cells, such as embryonic stem cell, I mean, this doesn't exist in the heart. I mean, maybe people think that they do. I don't. Now, everything, every process that takes place during the response of the heart to stress are controlled by what we call the cardiac gene regulatory network, then, which is itself controlled by transcription factor, cardiac transcription factor, and obviously proteins. But more and more, the importance of the non-coding genome has been recognized. So I'm not going to tell you about microRNA. I mean, you know about it. We're going to focus the talk on long non-coding RNA. But before I do that, I'd like to tell you a little bit about Notch and how we came out to recognize the importance of Notch in the process of this adaptation of the heart to stress. So Notch, again, I mean, this is not something that needs a lot of introduction here. So communication system, we need two cell type, one sending signal, the other one receiving the signal. Upon interaction of the ligand and receptor, Notch is cleaved, translocated to the nucleus, and then activate gene expression, target gene expression. Now, Notch is recognized to be important during development. This is known. The question is whether it could play a role in the adult heart, and this is still under investigation, I would say. So what we initially did was to try to identify the cell that signals through Notch. And if you do perform just a simple staining for NICD, the Notch intracellular domain of Notch, you see cardiomyocyte, you see also non-myocyte cells. And if you look for Jagged1, you see that Jagged1 is mostly expressed by cardiomyocyte. Then you have probably niches of cells that are non-myocyte cells that do express also a cardiac transcription factor. So there's evidence that both non-myocyte cells and myocyte cells signal through Notch. Now, if you isolate the cells, the non-myocyte cells, and then culture them under the appropriate condition, what you do see is that, first of all, these cells downregulate Notch signaling during differentiation. They commit to the cardiogenic lineage by overexpressing cardiac transcription factor, but eventually also produce mature cells. And if you add DAPT in this experiment, you accelerate the process. So inhibition of Notch seems to be a prerequisite for producing mature cardiomyocyte. Okay, with this in mind, what we did with that, we tried to produce more Notch signaling in the adult heart. And we saw that by overexpressing Jagged1 on the surface of cardiomyocyte, we could favor the production of cardiac precursor cells in the heart, since these cells, cardiomyocyte overexpressing in Jagged 1, would signal not only to adjacent cardiomyocyte, but also to the non-myocyte cells surrounding this cardiomyocyte, particularly fibroblast in cardiac precursor cells. So the idea was to favor this arm of the response. So this is the transgenic we generated. This is the gene. I mean, you have overexpression of Jagged 1. You can detect it by immunostaining. And what you observe is more notch signaling, as judged here by NICD staining. So they have more cells signaling through notch. And these cells are both cardiomyocyte and non-myocyte cells. Now, what is the phenotype that developed in this animal? Well, first of all, we performed an experiment in which we inject BRDU in neonatal mice and then analyze the number of BRDU positive cells in the heart in animals at 4 weeks of age. So you have more BRDU positive cells in the transgenics, but also, I mean, that are cardiomyocyte, but also more BRDU non-myocyte cells. And if you analyze NKX2.5 expression in these cells, you see that you have also more precursor cells in this animal. So the question of whether these cells contribute to produce more cardiomyocyte. Well, what we see in the adult animals, if we repeat the same experiment, but in this time after stress, this is a transaortic constriction model. What we see in the wild-type animal, you have massive production of myofibroblasts. I mean, they differentiate as expected, right? But this doesn't occur in the transgenic after stress. So now if you analyze the cells that incorporate BRDU, you don't have much difference between the transgenic and the wild-type. However, in the transgenic, BRDU is massively associated to myofibroblast. This is not the case in the transgenic, in which you see more precursor production. So the situation is this one. We have a wild-type situation in which we have probably notch that is activated under stress and contribute maybe to the production of precursor cells. In the transgenic, this is exacerbated. However, as I mentioned at the beginning, probably notch signaling somehow inhibit the maturation of these cells and the commitment, the full commitment into the cardiomyocyte fate. So we asked the question whether in the transgenic we could promote cardiomyocyte production by inhibiting notch at a given time point during the response to stress. And for doing so, we took advantage of antibody targeting the notch receptor that has been produced at Genentech by Chris Siebel. So this antibody blocked the notch response much more specifically than DAPT or other inhibitors. So the experiment was this one. We had the very same experiment in which we have the wild-type and transgenic animals. We have the stress, BRDU. And then we administered the antibody. What you do see is that hypertrophy, the compensatory hypertrophy is reduced upon injection of the antibody. The ejection fraction, cardiac function is improved. Fibrosis is decreased. And this is the most interesting part. What we see is more BRDU cardiomyocyte after antibody treatment in the transgenic, but also in the wild-type animals after TAC. Okay. So there's a pool of precursor probably in the wild-type already. The difference is there. So the transgenic produce more precursor, and both animals, upon inhibition of notch, produce more cardiomyocyte, or apparently produce more cardiomyocyte. Since this BRDU staining, this is not from proof of production, right? Now, to formally prove that you can have recruitment of precursor cells, we use this genetic fate mapping experiment, taking advantage of, well, this is very much the same as the ZEG mouse described by this group in the past, but we changed the ZEG mouse. We used the tomato GFP animals. So it's basically the same idea. Upon a combination of this particular part of the transgene, tomato cassette is ejected and then GFP start to be expressed. Now, if you combine this with a transgene in which the recombinase is under control of a cardiomyocyte-specific promoter, then you can change expression in cardiomyocyte from tomato expressing cardiomyocyte to a GFP. Okay? So now it's very simple. During the chase period, you ask whether your cardiomyocyte are produced by cardiomyocyte. So the cardiomyocyte and B or DU cardiomyocyte should be green. If they come from non-myocyte cells, they should be red. And this is what we found. Now, immediately you can see that you can find a substantial amount of red cardiomyocyte in this heart. They're very easily identified. But what is remarkable in the experiment is that if you perform TAC and administer the antibody against NOTCH, then you have really a significant amount of cardiomyocyte that are produced by non-myocyte cells. And this sustained the hypothesis that precursor cells exist in the heart. They are the number are increased upon NOTCH signaling after a stress. But then, in order to obtain cardiomyocyte, you need to turn off these signals and produce mature cardiomyocyte. Okay, I'm going to leave you with this for the time being, and maybe we can come back in discussion, because the rest of the talk is about long non-coding RNA, but this is relevant to what I'm going to show you at the end. Okay. So if I come back to this, I mentioned that the importance of the non-coding genome in the response of the heart to stress. And the focus of our attention has been recently on long non-coding RNA. So if you're not familiar with this molecule, I'd like to briefly introduce a little bit about it, about them. So they are defined as transcript that are 200 nucleotides in size, or more than 200 nucleotides in size, and lack apparent coding potential. This is very simple definition that doesn't tell you anything about the function. Now, this is a simple slide just to show you the proportion of the genome that is non-coding in different species. And as you can see, this percentage increase with the complexity of the organism. So in mammals, you have 98% of the genome that is non-coding, as compared to 2% for the proteins, right? So the 20,000 coding genes represent only 2% of the genome. The rest is non-coding. And this non-coding genome is transcribed. 80% of this genome produce RNA. So the question is whether this RNA has function, important function, in particular during development, but also during the response to the environment cues. What we know from different fields of science is that long non-coding RNA do have function. And what is mostly apparent is that they associate with chromatin modifier. So they can act as signals to bring chromatin modifier to specific location in the genome. They guide these complexes also to particular genes, acting as scaffold, for instance. So they give specificity to a non-specific system. Chromatin modifiers are not specific, are non-specific, but long non-coding RNA, by associating to them, to these complexes and targeting this complex to specific location, give specificity to the system. But long non-coding RNA can also act as decoy, for instance, for splicing factors, but also for microRNA in so-called competing endogenous network. So they titrate down the amount of particular important molecule, either protein or microRNA, for instance. And they act also, they are produced also by enhancer sequence. And the long non-coding RNA that are produced by enhancers play important role in promoting transcription of target genes by allowing the formation of a particular loop between the promoter and the enhancer and bringing the machinery in close contact to the promoter. So in the cardiovascular field, there's very few of these long non-coding RNA that have been fully characterized. You might have heard of Braveheart and Fender that are important during the development and differentiation of in particular the heart. But there are also some that are important during the response to stress. MyHeart is a typical example of a long non-coding RNA that control hypertrophy. CHRF is another one, and so on. And there's also other cells in the heart that obviously produce long non-coding RNA that are important for during the response. So we have established kind of a pipeline to try to identify important long non-coding RNA. And this is very brief, but what we have, we isolate RNA basically from different samples. And we focus on the poly A plus fraction. It's complicated enough, but at least with the poly A fraction, we know a little bit about the structure and the beginning and the end of the transcript, so the size, and it makes it our life easier. This represents probably 25 to 30% of all long non-coding RNA. So, there's a lot to do. We perform a very deep RNA-seq, about 300 to 400 million reads per sample. This is important. I'll come back to that in a minute. And then we use different software to identify what is known, and what is known are obviously the messenger RNA and the annotated long non-coding RNA. And what is novel, we analyze the coding potential of this transcript. If they are apparently not non-coding, then we call them novel long non-coding RNA, obviously if they are also bigger than 200 nucleotides in size. Then we can analyze different way by integrating different database and by analyzing the expression kinetics, the tissue specificity, cell specificity. We do correlation with physiological parameters, and I explain a little bit our analysis of the chromatin landscape in a minute. So once again, just a point regarding the enhancer-derived long non-coding RNA, as I mentioned before. The long non-coding RNA act as a nation transcript to promote the formation of this loop between the enhancer and the promoter. So this is a typical cis activation, basically. But it can also promote the association with a promoter at a remote location in the genome. So that would be a pseudo-cis, I don't know how to call it, but it's basically the same mechanism as this one. Then you have production of the long non-coding RNA that can travel and reach other locations in the genome to promote transcription. That would be more like the trans activation. And obviously this long non-coding RNA can also exit the nucleus, reach the cytoplasm, and have different functions there. For instance, targeting microRNA. So regarding the importance of the sequencing, the depth of the sequencing, this is a retrospective study in which we have analyzed the number of long non-coding RNA we have missed if we have used the typical 50 million reads that everybody used for identifying transcript. And you see that we have missed about 75% of what we have found. Okay, and the reason is that the depth of the sequencing is important for discovery. So if you want to discover something that is very lowly expressed, which is the case for very important long non-coding RNA, you need to go as deep as 300 or 400 reads per sample. And this is an important point because if you want to detect nation transcript in particular, you need to go very deep, right? If something is expressed because it traveled, expressed at the high levels, then possibly you might use a more shallow sequencing. But if you're interested in enhancer-derived non-encoding RNA, which is our case, then you need to go very deep. So once you have now sequence, identified novel links, then you can again perform different type of analysis. So this is a study that we have published recently. So we have isolated tissue from the border zone of the infarction, performed deep sequencing, and then we interrogated a little bit these molecules, defining different by different analysis. I'm going to go through quickly. So what we have identified about 1,500 new genes that are expressed in the heart, and among these 1,500 genes, about 25% are modulated during the infarction, in the response to infarction. This is unsupervised clustering of the sample. As you can see, the MI sample really clustered together, the sham clustered together. I mean, this is important because it means that the response is homogeneous and reproducible. So at the non-coding genome, you have a coordinate response to stress. Now, what are these molecules? So this is an example of a novel link that we call novel link 6. As you can see, this one is expressed only in the heart, exclusively in the heart. We have checked more tissue, but I mean, this is clearly seen from the RNA-seq data. So this is a message. The long non-coding RNA are much more cell and tissue specific than any other transcript. And we have analyzed this globally. So this is 17 non-cardiac tissue, and we have our samples and the heart from the, this is data from the ENCODE. So if you have a red spot here, it means that it's heart specific. You can immediately see that the long non-coding RNA are more specific than the messenger RNA. And if you analyze this, you see that 60% of the modulated transcript are heart enriched. Okay, making fantastic targets and also biomarkers. Now, another feature of this long non-coding RNA that more likely associate to enhancer sequence. So this is one example, again, the same long non-coding RNA. So you see that you have here the K27 acetylation mark, and so this corresponds to an enhancer sequence. So again, if you analyze this globally, what you see that's the novel link RNA here are more associated, I mean, if you just focus on this purple box here, more associated to enhancers than any other transcript. And this is true in the heart, more than in the heart than in other tissue. This is also true during differentiation of ESL into cardiomyocyte. So we can perform the same kind of analysis. As you can see, again, the long non-coding RNA we have identified in the heart, actually, are not only expressed during differentiation of ESN to cardiomyocyte, but also associated to enhancer sequence that are active when the cells start to differentiate into immature and mature cardiomyocyte. And this is a different type of analysis, but it just showed you that you can identify here molecules that are uniquely expressed during particular steps during the differentiation process. So again, they would represent fantastic target to promote the differentiation of ES cells into cardiomyocyte. Okay, so this is a complicated study performed by someone else at the beginning, by the group of Bruno Warmstadt is the first author, but this is absolutely key. What these people have shown is that if you look at expression of a gene at particular step during differentiation of ESL into cardiomyocyte, you might have co-expression of particular genes, but this doesn't tell you anything about the function of this gene. So this could be a transcription factor, a channel, a contractile protein. They are involved in different biological process. Now, if you look at the chromatin state transition during differentiation, this is completely different. So these people have used these four marks and looked at the pattern of chromatin state transition during these four different steps during the differentiation of the ESL into cardiomyocyte. And they have identified 34 chromatin state patterns. And so they reassign each transcript, coding transcript, into each one of these patterns and define 34 coding gene clusters. And now they could show that the genes that are in the same cluster are involved in the same biological process, function. Okay. So this is the list of the different cluster and identified biological process associated. What is important is that you have a cluster here, 20 and 23 to 27, that are associated to contraction, heart development, and so on. Right? And you have some others that are more associated to housekeeping. No, so what we have done, that we performed the analysis for the long non-coding RNA we have identified and reassigned each long non-coding RNA to a particular cluster. And we assumed that by doing so, we would start to find function for this long non-coding RNA. Okay, so this is the result, basically. You can focus on this, maybe only. So what you see, this is for the messenger RNA. Okay. So it's obvious that the messenger RNA are primarily associated to housekeeping gene function. However, the long non-coding RNA we have identified are much more associated to heart development and contraction, showing the importance of this molecule for not only the response of the heart, but most probably for developmental process. So this is a brief summary of one of the about NovaLink 6 as an example. I mean, so this summarizes a little bit all what we've performed for several of this novel long non-coding RNA. But NovaLink 6 is downregulated in the border zone of the infarct during the response. It's positively correlated with function. See that kind of correlation we find is really as good as for the best marker of cardiac function we have available. Again, it's associated to an enhancer sequence. This is a true enhancer. We have data, you know, using the DNA sequence to promote direct expression of a reporter gene in the heart. NovaLink 6 is in cluster 25. And now what we try to see is whether we can identify molecules that are relevant for cardiac development and homeostasis in cluster 5 that could be target of NovaLink 6, since they are co-regulated. And we identify BMP10, which itself controls NKX2.5. And what we show here is that if you target NovaLink 6 using gapmers that are short oligo that induce the degradation of the transcript, we can downregulate NovaLink 6. But at the same time, we have an effect on BMP10, NKX2.5, but not on other coding gene, showing the kind of specificity we can have in the response. Interestingly, this is also true in humans. So using transmap, we can identify the autolog of different long non-coding RNA, in particular NovaLink 6. And this is the expression in aortic stenosis with preserved ejection fraction and in dilated cardiomyopathy with decreased ejection fraction. When you see what you have decreased ejection fraction, decreased function, you have also decreased expression of NovaLink 6, and this is significant, even modest, decreased NKX 2.5 expression. So it seems that what we have shown in the mouse is also true in human, which is quite reassuring, I would say. So, and the importance of enhancers derived non-encoding RNA. Since we have this finding that our non-encoding RNA are more associated to enhancer, we wanted to test whether this is something that has some relevance during development and in the adult heart. So what we used here is information to pick true bona fide, I mean, cardiac enhancer. I mean, the name are horrible, but I mean, they are named MM67 and so on. So these, again, are true enhancer because they can direct expression in the heart of a reporter gene expression. But what is interesting is that if you analyze now the expression associated to this enhancer, you can detect expression in the heart only and not in other tissue. And this enhancer are during development, I'm sorry, this is a different step during development. I think it starts at E9.5. You see that they are dynamically regulated during development. And importantly, the adjacent gene, the expression of the adjacent gene correlates with expression of the enhancer sequence. You can analyze this again in a model of differentiation to cardiomyocyte. And you can see also that you have a dynamic response of this enhancer sequence. So they are transcribed and again correlate with the adjacent gene expression. And most importantly, we can now manipulate the system and target the transcript only, not the enhancer sequence. This is one example for MM85. We can obtain, we can silence the expression of this particular gene, and you have an immediate effect on the adjacent target gene, in this case, myocardium. But not on a gene that is also close to the enhancer, actually closer to the enhancer than myocardium. This is also interesting. So you have true specificity of the effect. This is not something that's spread on the DNA bidirectionally. Okay, so enhancers are important, obviously, but super enhancers now are also very, very important, more recognized to be important. So I don't want to talk about super enhancers today, but I will just briefly mention it because I think it's going to be crucial in the future. What are super enhancers? Super enhancers are basically cluster of typical enhancers. Okay, so that if they're recognized by H3K27 acetylation, monomethylation at K4, then you can identify in the genome, region of the genome that contain a lot of this typical enhancer. And now these are called super enhancers. In fact, you can use different marks, mediator occupancy and transcription factor enrichment to rank all the enhancer. So, and the definition is that if you take the inflection point of this curve here, what is on the right-hand side is called super enhancer, and the other one a typical enhancer. And there's very few per cell of this super enhancer. But the importance is that they control the identity of the cells. So typical super enhancer that are active in the cardiomyocyte wouldn't be active in the fibroblast, for instance, and the vice versa. So they make excellent target for modulating the fate and also for maintaining the cell integrity during the response to stress. Okay, so now you can imagine a lot of different things to do with this long non-coding RNA. Obviously, you can if you want to promote regeneration, which is our ultimate goal, well, I mean, you can manipulate cells in vitro. Fender and Braveheart would be a good example of long non-coding RNA that can promote the differentiation into cardiomyocyte, but we have now many others. But obviously, you can also work either by targeting endogenous population, either after isolation or directly in the heart. I mean, there's different strategy that you can imagine to promote recruitment of progenitor cells, proliferation of cardiomyocyte, modulation of the fibroblast behavior, and so on. So I'm going to give you now an example of such a study that we have performed in human cells. Okay. So it all started with this this project in which we have isolates fetal cells, human cardiac precursor cells, from the fetal heart. What we have isolated is a population that resembles mesenchymal multipotent cells, but that express that this cell express cardiac transcription factors. So that's the reason why we call them cardiac precursor cells, because they are probably multipotent, but they are committed already to the cardiogenic lineage by expressing this cardiac transcription factor. And in fact, if you differentiate the cells in vitro, you can obtain cardiomyocyte quite nicely. Good proportion of this cell would differentiate, 20%. I mean, this is good number. And you can reproduce this finding in vivo by injecting the cells into the SCID mouse and then produce cardiomyocyte that nicely integrate in the mouse heart. So we decided to use this system to see whether we can identify non-coding RNA that would play a role in this differentiation process. So we compared undifferentiated cells to differentiated cells. Okay? To make a long story short, we have identified a number of these links, but I'm going to focus on one particular transcript that, because we identified three isoforms of the same gene that we called Carmen for cardiac mesoderm enhancer derived non-coding RNA. And Carmen is interesting because it is actually in the locus containing also MIR-143 and 145. So as you can see, Carmen is highly expressed during differentiation, and the three isoforms are. So now this is the recognized nomenclature for Carmen. We couldn't use the E because someone already used the name for BCL10 gene some time ago, probably. Carmen is the, so this is the symbol of the gene. So. Anyway, so again, so the Carmen is actually in the locus containing these two mirs, 143, 145. But also, and so it has also autolog in the mouse, which also are in the same locus. And interestingly, in the mouse, the locus contain also Braveheart. So you have a probably complex regulation. The Braveheart is important for the cardiogenic commitment of ESL. The situation is much simpler in human because Braveheart doesn't exist in human. So fortunately enough, we used human cells. That makes it a little bit simpler. But keep in mind that it might be different in the mouse. So Carmen is actually an enhancer. It's a super enhancer. We actually tested the whether it was an enhancer using a reported system. So it does direct expression in the heart. Importantly, during differentiation, you have an inverse correlation with MIR expression. Okay, so when Carmen is up, the MIR are down. Now, Carmen is important for cardiogenesis. And this summarizes a few experiments we have performed. So in this experiment, we have tested whether we can inhibit cardiogenesis using gapmer targeting Carmen. So if you first concentrate on the white bars, you see that we can downregulate Carmen isoform using these particular gapmers. And what we do is that we inhibit the cardiogenic program. Transcription factor are down, the myosin heavy chain are also down, and so on. And what we observe is also upregulation of the two mirrors under this situation, confirming the inverse correlation between Kármán and the two mirrors. So we asked whether the mirror were important for cardiogenesis in this process. So we reintroduced the mirror by using mimics. But what you can immediately see is that the mimic have no effect on the cardiogenic program. However, the mimic works. We can detect the re-expression, and that's our target genes of the mirror, so we can show the down-regulation. What the mirror does, what we do, they actually favor the expression of this smooth muscle myosin heavy chain. And this is known that the two mirrors are involved in smooth muscle commitment, and I'll come back to that in a minute. So the message from this experiment that Kármán is important for cardiogenesis, but independent of the mirror that are in the same locus. So it must be something that is a trans effect that targets different genes at different locations. Okay, I'm going to introduce now a second type of cells. Because obviously the fetal cells are very nice, but what we want to target are the adult cells. So we isolate now the same type of cells from the adult heart. So again, I mean, they share similar phenotype. Mesenchymal stromal cells expressing cardiac transcription factor, nothing particular. Now, if you differentiate these cells, you will never obtain a cardiomyocyte using the same protocol we used before. Instead, you start to produce smooth muscle cells. So we have a situation in which we have now fetal cells that produce cardiomyocyte that obviously activate Kármán, but downregulate the mirror, and an adult cells that activate Kármán, but much more during differentiation. But now the situation is completely different at the mirror level. We have now mir-143 and 145 that are up. Now, as I mentioned briefly before, the two mir has been shown to be important for smooth muscle differentiation. So basically, the two mir promote differentiation into smooth muscle cells. What is also important is that the two mir expression are the control by an enhancer that now we know is Kármán, which is a target of the Notch pathway. And what these people have shown is that in this situation, Notch activation promotes expression of this two mir and promotes smooth muscle differentiation. Okay, so it's quite complicated, but we're getting there. So what we did is that we compare the Notch pathway in the fetal cells and the adult cells. And what we found is that, in particular, the ligands are very much down-regulated, suggesting that the whole system is down in the adult cells as compared to the fetal cells. So we asked the question whether we could restore cardiogenesis by reactivating the Notch pathway in the adult cells. So we used a very nice protocol, thank you, in which we expose the cells to immobilized ligand. And as you can see, you can activate Notch in these adult cells nicely. You promote proliferation and more expression of cardiac transcription factor. So some kind of commitment of the cells. So we would say, okay, we're there. So now we have to differentiate this, and we're going to obtain cardiomyocyte. However, it doesn't work as simply. What we observe is that you need to introduce an inhibition of Notch in order to obtain cardiomyocyte. And this is, again, because most probably Notch block the full maturation and commitment into the cardiomyocyte. So we have this protocol in which we expose the cells to a Notch ligand. And then we differentiate the cell either in the absence or the presence of DAPT. If you do so, you see that you start to obtain a good a response in terms of cardiac transcription factor expression only when you have DAPT during differentiation, but only if you have previous exposure to Notch ligand. If you don't expose the cells to Notch ligand, or if you don't have DAPT, you will never have this induction. Now, in turn, now you start to express proteins that are expressed by mature cardiomyocyte. And importantly, you see that you start to downregulate smooth muscle myosin heavy chain. And at the end, what you have is no more smooth muscle production, but cardiomyocyte production in the culture. Very significant amount of cardiomyocyte. Now, these cells demonstrate features of mature cardiomyocytes. This is one example of what we have performed. They do express calcium handling protein. They do respond to field stimulation. All parameters are improved. We can inject the cells into SCID neonate. If the cells are exposed to delta-like 1 before injection and the animals receive DAPT, now you start to produce patches of human cardiomyocyte in this mouse heart. And this is confocal microscopy and reconstruction of the different patches. So this is really demonstrate integration of human cardiomyocyte in the SCID mouse heart. So what happened with Carmen? Well, the Carmen in the situation that produced cardiomyocyte is downregulated. Okay. And the mirror are also downregulated in this situation. We do have re-expression of the target the gene of the mirror that which is expected, that we know promote proliferation and no differentiation into smooth muscle cell. And we know that the microRNA important for the smooth muscle commitment using this by this experiment. So if we now use a protocol in which we have no exposure to Notch ligand and no DAPT around, so we produce smooth muscle cells, we can inhibit the commitment to smooth muscle cells by targeting the microRNA using LNA inhibitor in this case. Okay. So if you use, if you downregulate 143 or 145, then what you do is that you start to downregulate the expression of the myosin heavy chain, smooth muscle myosin heavy chain. And if you target those microRNA, then you start to express cardiac specific proteins. And you restore the capacity of the cells to produce cardiomyocyte. So the smooth muscle commitment is mere dependent as compared to the other one. Now we've been able to clone these cells, so that is very important. So this is again the surface phenotype, not much new about it, but I mean, importantly, if you use clone, and we have many now, we can absolutely reproduce what we have seen with the body culture. So this is a cell autonomous effect, not something that a mix that would contain several different precursors that are used at different time. Now, Carmen, there's not only three isoforms, there's 10 isoforms that are produced by this locus. Okay. So we have detected three that are highly modulated during fetal cell differentiation, but there's more. So this is we study just the expression of this different isoform. I mean, we could study only 8 because we could. It's difficult to have isoform-specific PCR in this case. But so these are the 8 isoforms we have studied. So during fetal and adult cells differentiation, but also in adult cells that are committed to the cardiomyocyte fate. So what you can see is that. Well, basically, all these isoforms downregulate somehow when the cells, the adult cells produce cardiomyocyte. But what is more interesting is this one here. This is the only one that is downregulate during the fetal cells differentiating spontaneously into cardiomyocyte. And Carmen 7 is here. You see that it has this unique exon. So that would be that made an excellent target for a gapmer. So we designed gapmer targeting Carmen 7 exclusively. Okay. And see what was the role of Carmen 7 committing the cells to one or the other fate. So now we have an experiment in which we have, first of all, Carmen expression before or after gapmer treatment. So we have gapmer targeting all Carmen isoform and the Carmen 7 gapmer. So this is just to show you that this is specific. So Carmen 7 gapmer target only Carmen 7 and not the other isoform. Okay, so what happened during differentiation? Well, first of all, as you can see, MIR143 and 145 are downregulated if you target all Carmen isoform or Carmen 7 only. So the MIR modulation is Carmen 7 dependent. But then, if you look at the expression of the marker for smooth muscle commitment or cardiomyocyte commitment, what you see is that, first of all, when you have smooth muscle, in a situation when you have smooth muscle production, it's sufficient to target Carmen 7 to downregulate myosin heavy chain, smooth muscle myosin heavy chain, and to diminish the amount of smooth muscle myosin heavy positive cells in the culture. So Carmen 7 controls the smooth muscle commitment. But now, if you need, the notch modulation, so the other modulation, the modulation of the other isoform of Carmen in order to obtain cardiomyocyte. And this is what is shown here. You need first exposure to notch and DAPT. But if you target Carmen 7 at the same time, you produce massive amount of cardiomyocyte. And this is shown here. 60% of the culture produce cardiomyocyte in this case, which is absolutely massive. And this is a clone. This is not the bulk culture. This is a clone. Okay. Okay, so I've tried to summarize this in most simple way. I don't know if it's simple enough, but we have, again, fetal CPCs that spontaneously produce cardiomyocyte. And in this case, we have Carmen's isoform that are up but Carmen 7. Right. And this correlates with a downregulation of the MIR. In the adult cells, all Carmen isoforms, including Carmen 7, are upregulated during the differentiation into smooth muscle cells. And in turn, we have expression of the MIR143, 145. Now, if you want to obtain cardiomyocyte with these cells, well, you can modulate the system by exposing to activating notch in these cells. And this would result first in a reprogramming by induction of the cardiogenic program. But then, on the same time, you also activate Carmen 7 and sustain the expression of this particular isoform. So you need to kill this arm in order to obtain a cardiomyocyte. And this can be obtained by either targeting notch in a second step using DAPT or by targeting Carmen 7 using gapmer. And in this case, you will obtain cardiomyocyte. So this is a complicated system, but that is an example of how non-encoding RNA could be used to reprogram cells to the fate to the desired fate, basically. In our case, it's cardiomyocyte, but we're absolutely sure that many systems of such complexity operate during development or during the response to stress to produce the appropriate cell type, and sometimes the non-appropriate cell type. So this is a summary. I think what I'd like to stress particularly is the importance of enhancer associated long non-coding RNA, not only for differentiation, but also for maintaining the integrity of cells during the response to stress. There's a coordinate response of long non-coding RNA during the adaptation of the heart to stress. And this is major because this means that now we have targets, therapeutic targets. I gave you the example of Carmen, which is a super enhancer associated long non-coding RNA. What I haven't shown you is that Carmen is indeed upregulated in the human heart during the response to stress. Obviously, it's tempting to speculate that it could be a target to redirect maybe a pool of precursor into the cardiomyocyte fate in the adult human heart experiencing infarction, for instance. Carmen also obviously regulated the fate not only in of precursor cells in cardiomyocyte, but also in smooth muscle cells. So you could imagine different strategy to improve whatever you want to improve, production of cardiomyocyte or perfusion or whatever. So this is a picture that we took recently in Buenos Aires. So just to tell you, we can have fun in science. It was fun. Okay, so I'd like to acknowledge the work of the different people that have been involved in this work. Where is it? Okay, Isabelle Plaisance is the person who isolates all the human precursor cells. She's here. And Samir Unzain is our long non-coding person, very, very active in this field. But now we have three PhD students working on long-coding RNA. Each one of them have a project that is very exciting. We might have a chance to discuss a little bit this finding this afternoon. But I tell you that we can target long-coding RNA. We can modulate the response to stress and generate beneficial effect in the heart after infarction. So with this, thank you for your attention. I'd be happy to answer questions.